But you know, Anna has her restaurant at King's of Town, which she named her dad and her brother. Yeah, and it's, yes, you should really, if one day you have one.
It is, my name is Mike Hirschfeld, and I'm not sure I've met everyone, but I am the very proud head of school here at Kent. And I'm thrilled to be with you this afternoon. I'm supposed to give very brief remarks, but it's hard when the context is rowing. For those of you who know me, rowing is extremely important in my own development as a human being. And I believe, I talk about this all the time, that the Housatonic River and what happens on it is one of our most powerful classrooms. So my thank you to you for supporting the teaching and learning that happens on the river and in buildings, these buildings, is really heartfelt, and I know tremendously impactful for the young people who have the good fortune of rowing, the privilege of rowing at Kent School for the coaches that we have and their teammates. So thank you very, very much for supporting in a really significant way that teaching and learning. It's been fun for me to catch up with friends and that I've met over the years and have been involved in the sport, with including a teammate, Matt Camuso, who actually is responsible for me being here. He doesn't remember this, but when Matt and I were teammates in college, there was an alumnus who was coaching at our university at the time, a guy named Curtis Jordan. Matt Camuso and Hart Perry and Curtis Jordan had a whole lot to do with me arriving here as a fresh out of college kid to teach, and then obviously coming back here. It's been wonderful. So again, I'm not going to make this about me. I'm going to make this about Ron. I will say I'm sorry that a few folks who have funded boats are not here with us today, and folks that we're honoring. And among them, and I may be missing a couple, are Susanna Brown, Scott Barnes of the class of 1989. Thomas Post, class of 79, who's honoring his father, Robert Post, of the class of 46, and John Wasson, of the class of 1963, as well as, I learned, Tegan Kempia, who can't be with us today. But thank you, and I'm sure I might be missing someone, for all of you who have been so generous. I think I mentioned the boathouse as a classroom and the river as a classroom, and at the risk of being struck by a bolt of lightning from Father Sill above, I would argue that this might be our welcome.
I have the best time.
Perfect time.
Good to see
welcome.
You.
I was going to make a terrible analogy about the boathouse being similar to a chapel, but I won't. But I will offer a blessing of you and of the boats that will do some of the teaching I just talked about. Let us pray. Almighty God, who guided Noah in the building of the ark and calmed the raging sea, we call upon you to bless those who have prepared these boats for service and to protect and preserve those who will row in them and surround them with your loving care. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
It is now my pleasure to introduce Christine Wilson, our head girls rowing coach.
So for 49 years, girls from every zip code in the country and postal codes across the world really gathered here at Kent to learn about rowing and to join in this fabulous tradition that had really been the reason that the school was founded where it is. But as of last year, that tradition took a big turn, and thanks to your generosity, we have now developed this quite exciting sculling program with a fleet of equipment that I've actually never experienced as a coach. I've never seen so many new boats come into a program over a short period of time. And we are enormously grateful to you for that understanding of what this program could mean. What changed last year was that the requirements for what it meant to train and meet the demands of the sport sort of broke down this conventional model of trying to build teams, putting them all together in these big boats. And so now we have these individual building blocks, right, these tiny little boats that really parallel, I think, the reason that many rowing athletes decide to become coaches. And so in order to row on these small boats, you actually need to be a pretty big risk taker. You need to develop a real confident sense of yourself and having a plan and organizing yourself to just get on the water every day. And then you have to coordinate yourself with your teammates to just understand the logistics of a training session and be where you need to be on time without a clock telling you what to do. And so all of these skills that seem kind of normal if you've been in the sport for a long time are now skills that we have the opportunity to teach to any Kent girl who decides that she wants to row in the fall in this varsity program. And so what we have seen has been just a tremendous amount of growth that not only enables us to have these pretty sophisticated training sessions that involve the Swiss timing team of our coxes stationed at one end of the river and trusted coaches and coxes at another end of the river. A lot of math done by hand. And girls make their way from one end of the river course to the other. Not doing such a great job of navigating the river in the first instance, but then becoming pretty savvy about what the best route is to post a faster time on the clock. And we've been at this now since September of last year, and it really is kind of amazing to me, even though I've coached lots of teams, but it's amazing to see how far these girls have come in such a short time. So for those who were involved last September, who came back early for training this September, they're just in such a better athletic place. And all of these small building blocks really do allow us to put together better teams of girls come spring. And later you're going to hear some of the reflections of the athletes themselves and what they learned through sculling. But I think that the notion that what we're doing is separate from the development of crews is not at all the case. If anything, we're just giving the athletes better skills, better self-confidence, an opportunity to really come together as crews with a much better understanding of what it takes to make a boat move, what their individual responsibility to each other is to show up every day in training, which makes race day a lot more fun. So the reason I keep mentioning 49 years is that this year marks the 50th year of girls rowing at Kent School. And as you see from some other notices that are on your tabletops. In addition to this fantastic day of celebration, we hope that we'll see many of you back with us in November for the anniversary celebrations of 50 years of girls rowing at Kent. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. In reference to Michael's prayer, I'm glad it's today that we have this ceremony, because we would have needed the prayer to calm the raging seas. A couple days ago, after the tropical storm came by, and the river has receded quite a bit, about 2-3 feet since then, and it actually blew us off the river on Monday, and then yesterday we were sort of restricted into some bigger boats and some very talented small boat. So I'm glad it's today. I'm going to give you more of a historical reflection, if you will. So, excuse me, I get it.
No.
All right. It's a genetic thing. My dad did this, and it's driving me crazy. All right, back in 1999, so we're talking a different century. That was a special team for me. It was my fourth year as a head coach, and I had some shoes that I had to fill, and some slightly big shoes. Hart Perry, who was known throughout the rowing world, a legend. The team earned a silver medal at NERA, and it was a very close race for first. And at that time, I thought they had the speed to compete at the Royal Henley Regatta. And so that was my first crew that I took over there. The fact that this particular crew would be my first team that I would take to Henley, as and many more followed as the head coach, that in itself was fairly memorable. But it's not really the main fact that sort of sticks out today. On that team, I had a set of German brothers who were in the first boat, and one was a senior at the time. And when I announced this, that we would go to Henley, all the kids were very excited and everything. He came up to me afterwards, sort of quietly and looking down at his shoes, and said, you know, coach, as much as I would love to do this, I have a mandatory service for the government. I have to join the military in the summer. And so I'd rather not. Why then? I don't know. I'd rather not, you know, spend my time here training and then go off to service without seeing my family. I haven't been home in, you know, basically all year, or I'm not going home during the breaks. And that was a devastating blow. It could have been a devastating blow to that particular boat. So I had to think about that fairly quickly, and I said sort of off the top of my head, all right, I'll make a deal with you. If you find a place that we can train in Germany, you can go home after graduation, and we'll join you. And we'll join you. Right? Yeah, of course. Having no idea if I could pull this off. Well, he did. He talked to his coach at home and found us a couple shells to use and a couple launches. And great. And he went home after graduation. We had a spare row in the boat for about a week or so, and we flew over to Germany. And he didn't tell me that this particular boathouse was in the Black Forest. Gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous. Not a living soul anywhere. There was no hotels, no restaurants. All right, it was a gorgeous place to row, big lake and everything. We ended up staying in a youth hostel, which was really sort of cool. And then we had the lake to ourselves because they were having the Germany National Championship in Munich, so all the boats were away, all the teams were away. And one morning after a pretty tough training session, we came back, and I look up by the boathouse, and there are all these small boats, singles, doubles, quads, of all different sizes, you know, big wooden dory type things, racing shells and the like, and they were all little kids, ranging from 8 to 13 years old. And they were just out there just having an absolute blast. They're throwing water balloons at each other, and they're spending, you know, an hour and a half, 2 hours just rowing around and having so much fun. And I looked at that and I said, that is the problem with our rowing in the United States. We don't do that. We get to get our kids in a very short period of time, at least we used to, in which we would throw them in big boats and then teach them how to sweep. Whereas in Europe and England, they start with the small boats. They start with the boat field. They start with how can I make this boat move? But more importantly, they start having fun. They start just going out there and having an absolute blast. And so that's what was missing. So fast forward a couple decades, and here we are today. You know, as we look out over this amazing fleet, you know, it's pretty special that we've been able to do this. I realize how fortunate we are to offer such a program to our athletes. And for those of us who rode at Kent and look sort of jealously at this, right? Saying, wish we had this when we rode here, and there are a number of you that are here today. But I so appreciate the support from the administration to make this jump to a fall rowing program. I mean, a lot of our competitors have a fall rowing program, but very few have a fall rowing program like this. They're rowing eights and fours, and they're doing lots and lots of races and the like, and they're choosing their team that's probably going to be the 1B and 2B. In the spring, you know, where we get an opportunity to just throw these kids out there and have fun and get some good training, but more importantly, to use these small boats in a way that teach them the real boat feel and how to move a boat, which you don't get in a big boat. You can hide a lot of things in a big boat. You can't hide a lot in a small boat because you go over. The loyal alums that are all here today, your support over the years, but more importantly for this particular fleet, is going to make a huge difference in the next 100 years of Kent rowing. And to that, I thank you.
Are from the prologue for chapter 7 and the epilogue of Boys in the Boat. Rowing a race is an art, not a frantic scramble. It must be rowed with head power, as long as hand power. From the first stroke, all thoughts of the other crew must be blocked out. Your thoughts must be directed to your boat and your boat only. Always positive and never negative. Secondly, harmony, balance, and rhythm. They're the three things that stay with you your entire life. Without them, civilization is out of whack. And that's why rowers, when they go into life, they can fight it. They can handle life. That's what they get from rowing. Thank you.
My teammates have reflected on their experiences in the sculling program, and I'm going to share a few of their impressions with you. Training in sculling boats helped me become more aware of my body, especially how I move with the boat. My time sculling with Kent taught me how to communicate with my teammates and to be more independent on the water. I learned how to be more comfortable in all types of boats and to be okay initially feeling very uncomfortable in the small boats. Sculling has helped me learn how to be more responsible for myself on the water and not to just listen to a coxswain. It has been a privilege to get to know more about myself as a competitor while also watching the whole team grow as athletes. One of my favorite training memories is of being on the Housatonic in a single, training in a pack with my teammates, and racing each other during our weekly time trials. This new discipline has been extremely helpful for the growth of our team, and I'm so grateful to be a part of the sculling program at Kent. Sculling at Kent introduced me to the concept of flipping in a single, the swimming part of rowing, and how to survive the longest 5K of my life, an event also known as the Head of the Charles. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Before, Mike, do you have any comments for any before we...
I don't, and only this. There may be an opportunity for you to witness Eric and Christine's athletes throw water balloons at each other. I don't know where that
or
later, but no time other than that.
So the actual christening ceremony is about to commence, and Eric and Christine, I'll ask you to lead that. Just to explain what will happen from that point on, we'll come back after the actual christening ceremony, come back, we'll have some tea and or coffee, whatever, and congregate here for a little bit, and that will literally buy some time for the students to get down from lunch, and we're going to, actually, you will see your boats in the water, and that will kind of conclude the ceremonies for this morning. So with that, Chris and Eric, I'll leave it to you.
Great.
So what we've done is we've positioned some jugs of river water at the bow of each boat, sort of on the other side. Boys' boats are on the right-hand side, girls' boats are on the left. And so you can just find your jug down near the boat slang. Denny is passing out the script, if you will, that you can read. Which will include the names of the boat. Some boats have more than one name. As you just pour the river water over the bows of the hulls. And if you would like to say anything about why the boat has the name it does, please do so, because the student athletes are actually here. So they'll all be here for the actual christening.
So as and when we're ready, we'll literally we're gonna recongregate outside.
Thank you.
wearing my purse.
Having them wait till you're ready, okay? Have them wait till you're ready.
We're waiting for the live stream
video.
Oh.
Okay. The red button
is starting. Tell me how hard would you like to
post? Well, you can stand here.
Okay, are you going first?
I think I'm going last.
Are you going last?
I think it's going this way.
I'm going first.
Okay, so would you like to be at this side like this so we can see?
No.
Can you send those to me eventually?
I will do it right now.
Yes. I won't get it right now.
Yes. Think you can do both?
You good?
I think so.
Okay.
I read parts one and two, right?
Yep.
Both parts.
You guys good?
Okay.
As we're waiting for the live stream to kick in, those who are christening, read part one and two. As you are reading, or gracefully, Dana, back and forth over the bow. All right, try to make it last.
I know.
It's so important.
Should we be looking this way?
Okay.
Well, I had everybody sort of looking there, but
okay, so we should,
does that make sense?
We should go around them. All right.
Or do we? Yeah, because that's where the camera is.
Okay.
So everybody should be on the riverside of the bow so that you're facing the camera. And what we will do is once that's ready, we're going to start with Dana. We're going to work our way up to Coach McQuinney, and then we're going to start with Oliver and work our way up to the Camuso family. We're good? All right. Dana, please start us.
All right. I christened this shell the Dana Pierce, 1997, also known as the Barry Winslow. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in the sculling boat. Mm-hmm. And may the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used for competition.
I christen this shell the EBH. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in this sculling boat. And may the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used for competition.
So I christen this shell the RJL. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in the sculling boat. May the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passages whenever and wherever it is used in competition. And Christine told me I have to tell you what the RJL stands for. It's my three siblings, Rob, John, and Liz, who rode at Penn, Brown, and Hill.
Christen this shell the William Glover Doe 41. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in this sculling boat. And may the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used for competition.
I christen this shell the Kenneth M. Campia.
May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration to all students who train in the sculling boat. May the spirit of Kent School's name, River, ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used for competition. I christen this shell the Wren. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in this sculling boat. And may the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used for competition.
Thanks to the generosity of Susanna Brown, class of 89, I christen this shell the Coach McWinnie. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in this quadruple skull, and may the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used for competition.
I christen this shell Robert N. Post, class of 1946. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in the sculling boat. May the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used in competition.
We christen this shell the Victoria S. Poole. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in the sculling boat. And may the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used.
Christen this shell to be real. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in the sculling boat. And may the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used for competition.
As just a brief introduction, my brother was the class of 54. And I was 52. I christened this boat the Jenkins Brothers. The waters of the Housatonic provide inspiration for all students who train in this sculling boat, and may the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used in competition.
I christen this shell for Carol and Dick Caruso, parents of the children in the classes of 84, 87, and 90. May the waters of the Housatonic River provide inspiration for all students who train in this sculling boat. And may the spirit of Kent School's home river ensure safe and swift passage whenever and wherever it is used for competition.
Okay, thank you for all who took part today. Obviously, most importantly, for our honored guests and those who made this event possible by making these boats possible for these wonderful kids who will soon be out in the river all day, putting them into good use. So we have a few minutes to congregate, just to relax here, while the students have an opportunity to get changed, get out in the river, and then you'll have an opportunity to literally see your boat out in the Housatonic. Again, thanks all.
Great to meet you.
Gorgeous.
you for all of it.
Denny, did we get
there, right there.
Coach, can we steal you? If you want to put, go on the other side here. All right, perfect.
Perfect?
Yeah, all right. You got perfect. Here, hold on. I'm going to be really picky. There you go. Then you get the shot. Then you get the shot you want. Do you want a photo with that too?
Bad karma.
Yeah. Okay. I didn't know that.
Thank you.
Okay. Great. Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Down to the massing. That's where we bring the tire.
say, hey, but for this time of year, this oh, yeah. We have plenty of water.
Thank you.
Thank you. Go ahead and get changed.
Thank you. Thank you.